Oh, I will just let people start connecting before I'm ready, because I'm not ready yet. Why not? Okay. Let's get this stuff ready. We'll do it live! We'll do it live! That broken remote that I never bothered to put together, because it's broken. It's in pieces! It doesn't work. I don't even know why I'm messing with it, but we'll just play around with it. Why not? It's got nothing better to do. That's why. Let's put this up here. This thing's really busted up. Anyway, if anyone's starting to watch this video, or live stream, I should say, I'm still just setting up. This switch has literally seen a lot. In my previous job, I brought it in as a temporary switch, and it kind of fell. Just a little. I mean, and I'm trying to fix it because I am going to be reworking on CCNA stuff. Look, the rest of it's falling apart now. It's falling apart as I hold it. We're just going to mess with that, see if we can get anything to come out of it. I will have you a direct capture of a terminal client so you can actually see the output of it. If we can even get it going. I mean, the board's not even in it. And there's pieces of plastic just falling off. This poor thing has totally seen better days. Anyway, I actually really want to get a old toothbrush real quick. So I will be right back in a jiffy. Give me a second. Let me just put some text up there. In case anyone does start watching and they're like, look, I'm looking at an empty office. There we go. Ah, center, you son of a gun. I'll be right back. Wasn't long at all. All right. So I decided to use paper towels instead of a toothbrush because I don't know what else, what other chemical has been on that brush. And I certainly don't want to be pushing chemicals on this thing. If it isn't that good. So I have here with me some isopropyl alcohol. This one's 70%. I would recommend if anyone tries to clean stuff, use 90 or higher. But this is all I have. Just get it all nice and soaking and time to clean the board for now. So basically what's going on with this switch is basically what's going on with this switch is when you turn it on, it gets stuck in a boot loop, and it doesn't matter if you try and reset it like a factory reset. You hold down the mode button when you turn it on, and you erase the NVRAM. It still complains about port 7 as some kind of loopback failure, and that's not allowing it to properly start up. Now, the problem is, this may not be fixable. It's likely toast anyway, but I have a new Cisco coming my way anyway. It'd be nice if I can have them both operational, but what can you do? If it doesn't want to work, it doesn't want to work. Can I take these light pipes off? Yes, I can. Thank goodness. Yeah, these light pipes are just going to get in the way. Because port 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7's right on this one. And I want to clean everything, just in case maybe dust is causing it. And you'll see soon what it does if this doesn't actually fix it right away, which I really, really doubt it will do. Damn. All right. We don't need the light pipes right away anyway, so that's fine. There's a lot of dust in this thing. That's the only problem with a lot of networking equipment. If the closet that they're in is not clean, these things will suck up so much dust. And that's precisely what this does. It sucks up a lot of dust. Now, I think it was port 7 that had the problem. I'm not 100% positive now. I actually forgot. It might have been 7. It might have been off this one. I don't recall, but we'll find out. Why not? Anyway, let's get the bottom of it real quick while I'm here. I'll just put this over here. Why not? So you just want to try to clean it as good as you can. Get the dust off. Don't let your paper towel fall into pieces and leave stuff. That'll defeat the purpose of trying to clean it, you know. This is why you usually want a clean toothbrush, a clean one used for this purpose of cleaning with rubbing alcohol or isopropyl alcohol. I might have to turn that down in a bit. All right. It's already dried up. That's good. A little bit of paper towel there. So anyway, this is the board of a Cisco Catalyst 2912 XL. I don't know why it's an XL, because it doesn't have expansion modules at all. There's nothing like that in here. So I really don't know why Cisco called this an XL model, because the one I'm getting is actually an XL, and it, of course, has a lot of stuff. I turned up the squelch on this radio. Maybe it will stop. If it doesn't, I'll just shut the whole thing off. So now I'm just trying to get this board back in where it goes, which it's not very happy. It's a very angry board, of course. Well, I mean, think about it. If you were dropped, you would be angry too. Why won't you go in? Come on, go in. All right. Ground wire's in the way, of course. Okay, that's just being shut off. Sorry. Wow, this doesn't go in the way it's supposed to. See, everything's all bent up, bent out of shape. Nothing wants to fit. Sorry I don't have it on camera, but that's not really the purpose. The purpose of the video is to actually try to get it going again. So that, of course, is not what's being shown. Ah, there we go. Perfect. Got it. Yes. Kind of. good enough. Let's plug all the cords in. It's going to get a little loud, I will tell you. The fans on this thing are certainly a little old and ratty, but that's totally fine. I have no problem with that. All right, 2 out of 3 fans are plugged in, and the third one is in. Perfect. Power supply is connected. This bad boy is ready for some power. So what we're going to do, we're going to plug in the console cable into the back of it. And this is where we're going to open up PuTTY now. Let me just plug it into the other end of my serial adapter. You know, this is one of the things I don't get. When they sell these USB to serial adapters, why is it a male threaded screw on that end? It should be female, so that way whatever you're actually plugging into it can screw in. Someone didn't do their homework. They had one job and they failed at it. All right, let's get that PuTTY going, shall we? PuTTY. All right, let me configure it ahead of time. This is gonna be a serial connection at 9600 bauds. Unable to open connection. Oh, wait, it's trying to open up a real serial port. This is not a real one, this is a USB one. Unable to open serial port. Come on. All right, I'm just going to switch you guys over so you can see what the hell I'm doing here. Sorry if it's in 720p. Hopefully this is large enough for you to be able to see. So I need to actually figure out what this is showing up. USB 0. Okay, TTY USB 0. That's what I thought, but I did enter it wrong. That's totally my bad. All right, let's fix this. There we go. Now we have a connection. Perfect. Let's give you a window so you can actually see it. Why aren't we seeing the cursor? Ah, there we go. Of course, it's very, very typical of the X Window Manager. I have to use a Mesa workaround just so you can see the window. Of course. Of course. Anyway, we are ready to go ahead and plug this bad boy in and watch it not work. Gotta get the power cable real quick. Hold on. This ain't working quite as planned. All right, there we go. Apparently my power cord wasn't long enough. So this is what happens when you do things live. All right, plug it in. Oh, let's watch that thing boot. If it does at all. In fact, there we go. Now we're seeing something. Ah, well, I can't zoom that in quite like I thought I could. Oh, well. So it's going to run the, uncompress the iOS, and then from there it's going to go ahead and try to pull the configuration file, which right now there is actually no configuration on this thing. There it goes. See, now it's just, it's dumping everything and it's starting all over already, see? So what we're going to take a look here is I'm going to power it off so we can take a look at what failed. So something here obviously failed, duh. And we'll make this larger so we can take a look at that. So system restarted, and we can easily find the fail around here. Failure, front end post. Yeah, port 7, fast Ethernet 07. Looped back, packet not received. MTI test passed. And then that's when it basically just starts booting all over again. So we're not getting anything out of this. It's got a loop back failure. But why is the question? I'm going to power it on holding down the button. And then I'm going to go ahead and... because I can get it into a special mode if I do it that way. And I'm going to have to pull out my CCNA books to try to remember what to do. All right, I'm holding down that mode button right now. Come on, you can do it! Do something, please. Nothing? Okay. Oh, there we go. It was waiting for me to let go of the button. Anyway. So this is what we're getting now. The system has been interrupted prior to initialization of the flash file system. The following commands will initialize the flash file system and finish loading the operating system software. So yeah, let's go ahead and do it again. Because we do need that before we can actually go any further. Because then we don't want to load helper and then boot. Because we just need to get the flash system operational. Otherwise, we can't actually try to write anything or even erase it. Just in case there's still some remnants. The problem is, though, is the error it is reporting is a hardware failure. But here's the weird thing. It was working that day. Even after this whole falling down, it did work. And then just locked up and quit. But, you know, that's with technology. Anything fails at any time. So port 7. Let's go ahead and take a marker so I can actually mark which one it is. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. All right, that's marked. I'm going to mark it on the board so I know which one. And we're going to leave, I'm going to actually leave it in this mode, let it run a little bit, because what I'm going to actually do now is check all the actual chips that are actually responsible for the switching. So this is a 12-port switch. Now each switch, I believe, is 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Yes, so there's 3 switch chips in here, and they're all made by Level 1, and each one has actually got technically 5 ports, but 4 of them are the ones that are accessible as external ports, because the 5th port is how it actually interfaces with the system. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to actually feel the chip that is suspected to be faulty. And then from there, we'll be able to see if it actually is maybe got a bad short inside. Because if that's the case, then that's it. There's really not much you can do. So let me check. They're all equally the same temperature, so nothing is like overheating. So all the switch chips are the same temperature. So what that can tell me then from there is that there is likely a problem either in the software, which I don't see how, because, like I said, it was working. Well, I take that back. I was trying to open up the Java Virtual Switch Manager, which is Java-based, of course, because this is enterprise software. It has that whole GUI thing, and it was having a very hard time there, and I think what might have happened is that alone did something to the configuration. So what I'm going to do, grab an old CCNA book and see what we can do. Damn. Little known fact about me. I actually was CCNA. I never kept up on it. And of course, you know, if you don't keep up on it, you lose your CCNA. It's not a forever certification because networks change all the time. So let's see what we got here. We need to clear it. Old book. I think this book is like dated 1999. And even then, when I got my CCNA, this was still out of date. It doesn't even really go over EIGRP routing, which you really need these days. You need to know that stuff. I'm actually kind of relearning it all over again. So if anyone here is actually watching this video and they actually know Cisco switches, feel free to tell me the commands. I mean, I did it not that long ago, but I'll do it again. Here we go. If you want to completely clear all the configuration. There we go. I've got the page. Unknown command, clear. Oh, that's going to be lovely. This thing is really not working very well, is it? Unknown command. All right, so we got delete. We initialized the flash file system. Format a file system. Do we really want to format it? And DIR. Okay, so let's just... So what do we have here? You got flash, X modem, null, and BS. Yeah, that's right. This is BS. Okay. We don't want to boot. We're not there yet. So reset the system. Rename a file. Can make directories, but you can't change directories? Are we kidding me? FSCK, let's try that. Fine. Oh, what? It's been a while since I've done this. Because it's very close to being like Unix, but it's not. Okay, so of course it's unknown. Anyway, I guess we'll just format it. Yeah, it really wants that file system. You know what's really sad is I don't actually think the CCNA materials actually cover this mode that it's in right now, which is kind of sad. It really doesn't. Let me make that smaller there. There we go. Screw this. To the Googles! Use Google to figure it out, I guess. And hello, fellow YouTuber. All right, that's for our reset procedure for 25, 20, 37, 50. Resetting a catalyst switches to factory defaults. Alright, I found it on Cisco's website. Tells you to back up everything after the configure reset procedure running. Cisco Catalyst software. See, here's the problem. All the information here that I'm actually finding is referring to being able to actually boot the machine and get into your privileged modes. This is not getting that far, and I'm actually stuck completely here. No, so factory resetting a boot looping catalyst. We'll take a look here with me. No, a Cisco catalyst. No, not an IP phone. It's not what a catalyst is. Reset. Okay, here we go. So holding the mode button. Yes, this is the instructions I actually need for mine. No, this is totally not a Nintendo Switch. This is what helps your Nintendo Switch play games in the enterprise world. Like, your ISP uses stuff like this, but no, not that kind of switch. Alright, so I'm going to follow these instructions here. Let me just move some stuff out of the way. So I found some instructions. What we're going to do is really try to get this thing to do something for me. So I already initialized the flash file system, so okay, I do need the load helper. Rename the configuration file. Flash config.old. No such file. So, because it was already done. It hasn't even booted to create a config file. There's no startup configuration in this thing. Rename the configuration file. Use the boot switch. Boot the switch using the boot command. Ah. Okay, I figured out how the file system works here. Yeah, I really don't want to actually format that flash because there's the bin file that this thing boots. That would be horrible. It's not that hard. It's not that hard. People used to use DOS all the time and had no problem with it. Just think of it like a DOS. It's all commands. So I am, at this point, really at a loss. There is nothing that it could potentially be doing. So the other thing it booted up to is the diagnostics partition. The diagnostics mode, which is what I'm in right now. You have the HTML, which is for the web page. And you have environment variables. You know what? Yeah, I still have the chat open. I usually don't pronounce my last name on purpose because that way, if anyone calls me, I know if they know me or not. There's nothing in there that needs to be wiped out. I mean, it just has the serial number, which, whoopee-doo, you all see the serial number of my dead catalyst. I don't really care. So I'm going to go ahead and tell it to boot again and see if we get the same thing. If your autocorrect keeps autocorrecting words into other words, that's because you have misspelt that word, and you must have at one point told it that it is loom. So you would have to go into your settings and fix that. On an iOS device, I think it keeps a list. I don't know. I haven't worked at Apple in many years now. And Android, I think you just have to go into your keyboard settings and reset the personalization settings. Preparing to dump core! Yeah, it totally did not work. Damn! Let's turn it off. So this is not helping. Let's see here. Where are we? And it's just going to be complaining about port 7. But where did it complain about? There it is, Fast Ethernet 07. So Fast Ethernet 07 is still not... It's still failing a loopback test. A loopback test. Packet not received. Well, I guess what I can do is look in the port to physically see if anything's bent, but I don't think so. Nothing seems actually bent in this thing. If you're gonna DM me about the PS3 exploit, I'm holding off on it right now, honestly, because I still use it for everything I normally do, and I don't want to mess with anything anymore. The only thing I mess with right now is my old smartphone that I don't even use anymore, because this is actually my cell phone. It's cheaper, and I just want it to work. So I'm going to look in port 7, which I have marked, and see if anything is physically damaged. Nothing looks physically damaged in here. It does look, however, very old. So I'm going to Q-tip the... Actually, I have a Q-tip right down here I can just use. I'm going to Q-tip the socket. See if it helps. I mean, there's really not much I can lose at this point. The switch is being replaced anyway. Like I said, it would be nice if I can have two switches and have like a VLAN trunk going on. That'd be nice, but you can't get... Oh no, how'd that song go? You can't always get what you want, but if you try sometime, you might find you get what you need. Alright, let's see here. So another thing is that it is saying that the packet was not received. Now that can be happening in multiple different locations. Like it could be a cracked solder joint, a damaged trace. It can be any number of those things. And I'm just at this point just trying to find it. So what I'm going to do now is I'm actually going to pull out the board yet again and this time examine the bottom. I have here a jeweler's loop, which I can look right, like a microscope, right up to it. And that's what I'm going to do. So I'm going to disconnect power. Come on. My console cable. And all the fan connectors, because that's all cooling. All right, perfect. And now it should just come right out. Reluctantly so. you bought something to protect against viruses, I would be wary about anything. Whenever I see people say they're buying stuff to protect their computer, I just say go to Malwarebytes. It's free. I mean, it's not really a virus scanner, but it usually finds things like that, like ad pop-ups. If you get, and I don't do that stuff anymore. I gave up working IT. This one. I want to mark that with a marker yet again. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Yep. So I'm just marking it with a marker. And what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to follow the traces, see where they go, and try to find where this fault may be. So I'm just actually going to clean it real quick with the Q-tip that I have here. Now, basically, when the Cisco Catalyst turns on, it does a loopback test to make sure all of its interfaces are working. That's what the error message is referring to when it says it's failed the loopback test. It's strictly because of this. It's not able to determine if that port is even functional. Which is very much possible, unfortunately. So I'm just cleaning it all up. Actually, I need more rubbing alcohol on this. Let's see what we get here. You don't want too much. You don't really want to soak it or anything. Now, I guess I could lie to it and go in the diagnostics mode, go into the environmental variables, and technically tell it it's a shorter switch. Maybe a 4-port, but no such thing existed. Not from Cisco. All right. Time to look. So nothing is cracked. Actually, there might be a crack. Nope, there isn't. One, two, three, four. So it's going to go through this capacitor. You can actually really tell how it's all wired up inside. Learning that stuff for free? I mean, you can... online resources. There's stuff all over the internet to learn this stuff. In fact, there's a lot of stuff all over YouTube to teach you these kind of things. That's the extent that I can see from the bottom layer. I now need to check the top layer. Let's see what I can find here. Oh, that's the LED, and then it goes right into the switch. It has bypass capacitors on the bottom, but they all seem to be fine. I mean, visual inspections alone, that's not what you always want to rely on, but at this time, there really is no other inspection to find. So, unfortunately, I'm not seeing anything wrong on the bottom side, so I'm going to put it back in the case again. Get that darn ground wire out of the way for once. That'd be really great. There we go. Oh, of course, it gets buried because, you know, I knew something always has to go wrong. At least this isn't like the other video. The remote control. Well, it could be. Like the remote control video, because that really ended up in failure. This could end up in failure, too. You can't always repair everything. And something as professional like this, it's... They're not designed to be repaired, not by the end user or even the businesses. I mean, they're designed to be reconfigured. That's where you get the big bucks. But actually fixing the circuitry? No, that's a totally different level of repair. So what I'm going to do now is actually load this up with some rubbing alcohol because I want to get it under the where the loopback test actually takes place. Which is usually at the BEL. I forget what they are, but that's usually where it's going to be performing such a test. And I just want to soak it, basically, to try to get rid of anything that could potentially be on those pins causing issue. And I'll get the other ones while I'm here. Why not? Excuse me. Don't you go to sleep, computer. Computer was about to go to sleep. I ain't that boring. Alright, we're going to plug the console cable back in now, and we're going to go ahead and boot it up. See what we get. Alrighty then. It's probably not going to work. I wouldn't be surprised. All right, it's at the Ethernet controller, loop back, packet not received, port 7. Yep, of course. All right, so at this point, we're going to do a little research then on that particular error. But I am going to take a quick break. I will be right back. Okie dokie, I'm coming. I'm coming back. Okay. All right, so at this point, we're not getting anything anywhere with this switch. We need to find out what this actual failure point means. We can use Google. I'm not going to lie, a lot of us IT people just Google things. So we have the error message right here. It is loopback packet not received. And we're just going to Google this. Come on. Copying is hard. All right. That's not what I typed in, but welcome to the internet. Anyway, I'll just manually type it in, I guess. Post failure loot back packet not received. And we'll take a look at, we'll take a look here. Let's actually make another window capture for you so that way you can easily see it. There we go. Ain't that nice? Okay. To the Googles! Except I don't even use Google. And that's all they say, it's a hardware failure. No shit. I think I figured that out. But this guy's got it bad. It's failing all of his ports. That's totally not good. Alright, I'm gonna actually go into Google though. Sometimes DuckDuckGo simply does not find the results I actually want. Connect to an ASIC. It looks like the ASIC which connects to has gone bad. Yeah, I've noticed. Well, you know, DC, this is the only problem when you go through, like, the Cisco forums. Everyone's like, oh, get out the pocketbook. You know, bust out your wallet. RMA it. But, you know, real hardware guys dig into it. And we will figure that stuff out. Don't know why that was zoomed in. So this person's got a 2900 also, just like mine, and his died on port 8, which is actually the same ASIC that my port 7's on. Cisco has a lifetime hardware warranty on their fixed config switches. Yeah, I don't think they would honor it for mine. I mean, it's in pieces. Let's see.
It says you don't... Well, actually, you know what? They say you don't even need a contract. But I don't have a login. Can I just create one? Because I'll do it. I will do it. Ain't that fancy? All right, well, it looks like at this point, there's nothing I can do. It's a failure in the ASIC, which is this one right here. That's what port 7 lives on. And that bad boy has a failure, which, you know, as they say, what we have here is a failure to communicate. It does. It has a failure to communicate. I'm going to register on Cisco's site, see what I can do. So, yeah, I'll see what I can do. Anyway, I have nothing else to say. I tried. It failed. But what else can you do? Have a good one.